साक्षात् परम ब्रह्मा तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। वी आर इन अमृत अनुभव वर्स नंबर 52 चैप्टर 2। And last week we saw where Jnaneshwar Maharaj was giving an example of a lamp and a camphor. A lamp flame may need wick and oil, but the camphor does not need them to a flame. And there a lamp will require a container, it will require a wick, it will require oil, and then there will be light. Three things are required in order for light to appear. Same way, for any experience to appear, we have knower, no knowing, seer, seen, seeing, experiencer, experiencing. Three things are required. Then experience happens. But here, we want to go beyond that. What is that? But the camphor does not need them. Camphor, it is the material that is required for the flame to come is all within it. Camphor itself becomes the fire. Camphor is the fuel of the fire, and the fire, the flame, continues as long as the fire is. And when the fuel of a camphor is completely exhausted, along with that the fire also goes away and nothing is left behind. This manner should be our contemplation, that our mind must be like camphor, that when it contemplates on the reality, on the self, then the mind must vanish. Because understand very simply that mind is where duality presents itself, the aham idam. And when this aham contemplates using the idam, so right now what we are doing, we are all contemplating. Who is contemplating? I am contemplating. You are contemplating. So all of us are saying, I am contemplating at this moment, isn't it? And what are we contemplating with? We are contemplating with the words of Amrut Anubhav. And where are the words of Amrut Anubhav? Even the example of camphor taking us, it's taking us to the self. And what is it telling us? That our mind must, in this contemplation, in this fire of contemplation, it must exhaust itself of all thoughts, of all seeking, of all desire to liberate. See, can you bring that about? No, you cannot bring that about. You cannot bring that about. Then what can you do? All you can do is contemplate. Invoke the fire of contemplation and continue contemplating without distraction. And a moment will come where everything is exhausted. And there we are. And in this manner, the camphor of individuality is burnt. And when I use the word mind, mind is individuality. Then there is nothing left behind, only total submergence in the absolute. When all duality, even the there is no traces of duality left, even the last speck of the I thought also is burnt away in contemplation, there we are. From there on, now in the next, another example, तया दोहो परस्परे होय नाजव मेले रे तव दोही चे ही सरे सरसेची. द मोमेंट द कैम्फर एंड फायर मीट बोथ ऑफ देम डिसअपियर. ओके, वी हैव ऑलरेडी एक्सप्लेन बट हियर इट इज. द मोमेंट द कैम्फर एंड द फायर कम इन कॉन्टैक्ट विद ईच अदर दे नॉट ओनली कैन नो लॉन्गर रिमेन सेपरेट बट बोथ ऑफ देम डिसअपियर एंड लूज देयर सेपरेट आइडेंटिटीज. कैम्फर इज द क्रिस्टलाइज्ड इंडिविजुअलिटी when the unmanifest truth is invoked and it manifests as fire of knowledge or fire of contemplation, as I was saying. So camphor is the crystallized individuality. What is crystallization? Where I accepts itself as a form, itself accepts itself as the body, it accepts itself as the mind, convictions, birth. When it takes on the conditionings of time, space and objectivity, that infinite I becomes the individual I. This is crystallization of individuality. And then what is the fire? When this I contemplates on its own essential nature, that very moment the fire of contemplation begins. Whether it thinks about the own nature or it thinks about the divine, when the unmanifest truth is invoked, and how do we invoke the unmanifest truth? Initially only by words. Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta Swarup, the unmanifest truth is eternal, it is ever pure, Shuddha Buddha, it is all knowing, it is all pervasive, it is ever free, independent, and it is my nature. Don't forget that one. Buddha Mukta Swarup. Swarup means Swa is I. That is my true form. What is that true form? Formless form is my true form. And in this way, the I, the individuality, or the crystallized individuality, the camphor, starts contemplating. And both, as this contemplation begins, the fire of contemplation, just as the fire keeps using the camphor as the fuel, this fire of contemplation keeps using the individuality to burn itself, to maintain itself. And how, as I explained, I think in meditation I explained, how does the individuality maintain itself? By association with everything else, with idam, with thatness. Both the individuality, the camphor, and the manifested truth disappear. What is the manifested truth? Manifested truth can be the form of the Lord. Manifested truth can be the thought of your contemplation. It could be अहम ब्रह्मास्मि अहम ब्रह्मास्मि अहम ब्रह्मास्मि, दिस इज मैनिफेस्टेड ट्रूथ. व्हेन यू आर कंप्लीटली कन्विंस्ड सो मैनिफेस्टेड ट्रूथ इज द आइडिया विच यू हैव टेकन एज अ सपोर्ट टू फोकस अपॉन सरेंडर टू एक्सेट्रा एक्सेट्रा. तो बोथ द इंडिविजुअलिटी एंड द मैनिफेस्टेड ट्रूथ डिसअपियर. दैट इज द रिलेटिव एग्जिस्टेंस. द रिलेटिव एग्जिस्टेंस इज ट्रांसेंडेड. सो वेयर इज रिलेटिविटी, वेयर इज रिलेटिव एग्जिस्टेंस? इट इज इन द माइंड. एंड वॉट इज माइंड? अ प्ले बिटवीन अहम एंड इदम, बिटवीन आई एंड दैटनेस. All this dissolves itself. And when it's dissolved, the relative existence is transcended. That means the self transcends the I and that. And the original state, which is beyond manifestation and non-manifestation, is restored. So what is manifestation? At a larger level, manifestation is waking and dream. What is unmanifestation? Deep sleep. What is manifestation? Even as I am speaking right now, what is manifestation? Appearance of a thought in our mind. What is unmanifestation? The gap between the two thoughts. See? So this yo-yo business of manifestation and unmanifestation, all that is transcended, and the one who is beyond this is our true self. Then what will happen then? Then whether manifestation is there or unmanifestation is there, the self is not concerned. The water is not concerned by the manifestation of waves or the unmanifestation of waves. The water does not lose anything because a wave has appeared. And the waters do not gain anything if the wave merges back into the dies. Nothing has been added, nothing has been subtracted. What is the nature of the water? Purnamada, Purnamidam, Purnat, Purnamudachyate. That is my nature. I am complete. This transcendental state is a state of utter fulfillment, where there is nothing lacking. Nothing can be added to it, nothing can be subtracted from it. Sun is complete. Appearance of day does not reduce the light from the sun. And absence of the day or advent of the night does not make the sun get its light back. So same way, when the waking and dream experience, the manifestation happens, nothing is lost. I continue to be the same pristine, immaculate, unattached self. And when unmanifestation happens, I still continue to be the same. Nothing is added back to me. Living in this disposition is what Jnaneshwar Maharaj is used the simile of the camphor and the fire. In the same way, when the Guru Shishya come together, both manifestations disappear and that alone remains, which is beyond the spell of dual existence. We are in the chapter of Sri Guru Stavana, Glory of the Guru, and every verse is trying to put light on the Guru Shishya, who is a Guru and who is a Shishya. Here, the Shishya is being told that when he contemplates, he is knowing Guru only as a Guru because he is objective in his pursuit. self is the self, the word self, only because we are seeking it. And seeking is always objective in nature. But human beings have one extra faculty, that even while the words are being used, can you hear me? Okay. Because said internet connection weak, so that's why I asked.
Okay, thanks.
Where was I?
Bit of interruption.
That's okay. It will become okay. So even with the manifestation and unmanifestation, nothing has been lost from me and nothing has been added back to me. I continue to remain a complete whole. But as an individual, as a parent, when we are in relationship, see how many ways we make ourselves whole. By creating relationships, by having possessions, by creating a comfort zone for ourselves, by collecting memories. These are all ways of making ourselves whole. But no amount of all this can ever make us complete. Infinite number of finite associations is not equal to infinite. It will never give you the security. Instead, we have to take this position that I am complete. In me, the whole creation is coming and going. There is nothing lacking. The same thought is expressed through another example. Te vi dekhe nami yayate tavagele vandya vandite cheviliya kate swapnice jevi. In the same way, when one approaches the Guru, the duality of Guru and Shishya disappears, just as the experience of duality in the dream vanishes on waking up. We keep taking this example n number of times. I think in Vivek Chudamani we keep taking it, in Bhagavad we keep taking it. In this way, when the disciple is qualified enough to approach the teacher in the right manner and does approach the guru, the duality between the Vandya, the one who is looking up, the one to whom salutations are offered, and that is the guru, and the Vandaka, the one who is offering the salutation, that is the disciple, disappears. So important point here is, disappearing is not in our hand. Disappearing will happen. Then what is in our hand? Disciple is qualified enough to approach the teacher. Thinking about the truth, thinking about the self, anyone can do. I am the self. Is that enough? Merely thinking about the self is enough. But our thinking is what? Our thinking is with so many interruptions, so many distractions, so many agitations, so many expectations. So, as a result of all these, we are unable to remain steady in that contemplation. So, we have to qualify, as we did in this meditation today. That is qualification. That is one way. There are n number of ways. So where is the teacher? Here understand. Teacher is the self only. Uddharet atman atmanam, natmanam avasadhayet. The I, the individual self, is raising by contemplating on the infinite self. Both are self only. In fact, they are one only. But the mind has created the distance between them because of objectification of the self. So, with the right manner, what is the right manner? How to approach the Guru? Who is a Guru? Shrotriya Brahmanishtam. And how should the student approach the teacher or the Guru Maharaj, who is none other than the self? Samit Panihi Shrotriya Brahmanishtam Varishtam. Samit Panihi. Samit Panihi means he should approach the Guru Maharaj with dry sticks on his head. This is the traditional way it is given in our in Kaivalya Upanishad. And then, what is the significance there? The Samit Pani means the dry twigs. Dry twigs significance is that when the fire is lighted to a dry twig, it immediately catches fire without delay, no smoke. No smoke. When water is wet, the twigs are wet, which means attachment is still there, vairagya is not matured, emotionally we are caught up somewhere. So we have to work all that out. And then approach the Guru Maharaj, then approach the self. What is the right manner and the right qualification is indicated in the Mundaka Upanishad. The disciple approaches the preceptor with the, here it says, the preceptor with the dried wood in his hands. It comes in Mundaka Upanishad, not Kaivalya. With the dried wood in his hands, that is, with total dispassion, total renunciation, including that of one's individuality. It also means that the power of the hands, the Kriya Shakti, is offered at the feet of the Guru, who is Jnana Shakti. When the two Shaktis become together, there is manifestation of full glory. See? When the Kriya means activity, and Jnana Shakti is the power of knowledge, the power of activity and the power of knowledge. So there are three types of Shaktis we saw in the first chapter. What were they? Ichha Shakti, Kriya Shakti and Jnana Shakti. The potential of activity, the movement or activity will take, potential of knowledge and the potential of desire. So here our activities are desire oriented activities. Understand this. Even the seeking is desire oriented. And as long as we are within the mind seeking by ourselves, by our own notions, by our own ideas, by our own imaginations, reading books after books, watching this video, watching that video, opening this page, oh, today's message is this, tomorrow open that book, oh, today's message is this. Let me intuitively go, what is the message for me today? Go and open one book, today is this message. And then if the message of yesterday and today is the same, you disregard that message. And then you want to say, how can it be the same message? There must be something else for me. You don't accept it. You go to the next one. This is not seeking. So, giving up all activity means now we have become available as an instrument in the hands of the Guru Maharaj. And only by his prompts the activity happens. The seeker has surrendered all his desires. He does not want to act upon his desires. He only wants to act upon the words of the Guru, at the indication of the Guru, what's to be done and what's not to be done. Because he is the representative of Jnana Shakti. He knows what is right. And our mind is made up of all these three. So Guru will be the thought of the self. Ichha will be the thought of the desire of the individual self. And activity is the movement of thoughts. So our thoughts erupting in our mind, which is activity, is prompted by egocentric, selfish desires, or are they being prompted by contemplation, wherein the I has surrendered to the higher one, the higher principle, the Guru principle, the self. So our thoughts coming in our mind of the individual, are they as a result of contemplation, or are they a result of egocentric desire? When the two Shaktis come together, when there is no doubt as to, this happens when a student becomes Uttam Adhikari. Uttam Adhikari means, there is Uttam Adhikari, Madhyam Adhikari and Adham Adhikari. Adham Adhikari, the lowest type of qualified student, disciple, is who understands exactly the opposite of what the teacher has told. See? The medium, Madhyam Adhikari, he understands what the teacher has told, but forgets after some time. He is not able to hold on to it. And Uttam Adhikari is, the most qualified disciple is, Shishya is, that at that, so Madhyam Adhikari, he needs to reflect afterwards, he needs to contemplate afterwards, he needs to listen to the talk afterwards, he needs to meditate afterwards. Uttam Adhikari, even as the instructions are falling on the ears, knowledge is taking place. Examples, Arjun is an example. Parikshit Maharaj is an example. Parikshit, to whom Bhagavat was given by Shukdev Ji Maharaj. He did not do any sadhana. All he did was listen to Shukdev Ji Maharaj. Arjuna did not do any sadhana. He listened to Krishna Bhagavan. But while He was so alert, he was so single-pointed, he was so calm, cool, collected. Okay, he began in a Vishad Yoga, but he kept becoming more and more and more available to the words of Krishna, to the words of Shukdevji Maharaj. And the result was, all doubt was removed from their mind. Arjuna's all doubt was removed, and he says, I am ready to do whatever you tell me to do. I am ready to be the instrument in your hands, O Lord, to act out there in the world. And Parikshit Maharaj, he became available to himself as a result of listening to Shukdevji Maharaj. The entire Bhagavatam, when he listened, he became available. He transcended death, because in 7 days he was supposed to die by the bite of the Takshak snake. But when the snake came and bit him, he bit a body without any life. There was no owner available in the body. He had already disidentified. He had already realized that he is the self. And after Parikshit's realization, then the snake came. Can we say that if death comes right now, I am prepared? I have transcended death. Can we say that? That Takshak is death only. Have we prepared ourselves? Have we become reaction proof? Are we completely absorbed in that, surrendered or absorbed in that Guru Tattva, Guru Maharaj? That the idea that I am a seeker, that there is a self, both these ideas have vanished from our mind. See? How does the experience of duality disappear? Then there is manifestation of full glory. What is full glory? Then self, one without a second, alone is, that is the full glory. Ekameva Dvitiya, one without a second truth, reveals. Like the dream, and the contents of the dream hold no meaning on waking up to a new plane of consciousness, the waking state. In the same way, when one comes to discover one's own essential nature in the presence of the Divine Teacher, that very moment the whole duality and all its progeny are totally destroyed. The moment we come in the presence of fire, all cold gets vanished from our system. When we come in the presence of light, all darkness vanishes. Same way, when we come in the presence, in the proximity of the Guru Maharaj, that very moment, without any delay, instantaneously, the whole duality and all the progeny, that means mind becomes still. Duality makes the mind active. So, when we are cold, mind is active. Oh, it's so cold today, it is 3 degrees. Oh, it is 2 degrees. Oh, I need extra. I should increase the heater one notch up. I should wear extra jacket. I should do this. I should do that. So many thoughts with regards to cold. And then we come in front. Then the heater goes on. And as the heater goes on, slowly, slowly, the thoughts of feeling the chill they are vanishing out of your mind. Same way, when we come, many of you must have experienced when we are going to meet a master, we go with, so I'm going to ask this question if I get an opportunity, I'm going to ask that question if I get an opportunity. And when we go in the presence of the master, all questions vanish from our mind. Exactly the same way. Whatever ideas, imagination, convictions, notions this mind or intellect have with regards to the self, they are only as long as duality is there in the mind. But as it becomes adept at recognizing that Guru Tattva, which is beyond the mind, or the mind surrenders at the altar of the Guru, all duality vanishes. And that is told here, the whole duality and all its progeny, all its kids, they vanish in toto. How does one put this message into practice? By going beyond the sound of the words and reaching into one's own essential nature. We must not be addicted to the words, to the sounds. We should not be addicted. Addicted to the sounds is only intellectual appreciation of that principle that I am, the essence that I am. Reading, listening, it will, and obsession with that will only keep you in the mind. But you are beyond the mind, transcendental to the mind. So here the teacher says, how does one put this message into practice? By going beyond the sound of the words. So every time we use the word self, we use the word Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta Swarup, we use the word pristine self, we use the word Guru Maharaj, we use the word Guru Tattva. We must become subjective at that time. Guru Maharaj doesn't mean a person outside. Immediately we must become subjective. Each state of consciousness is composed of three factors: the waker, the waking, and the waking experience, the dreamer, the dream world, and the dream experience, and so on. When one wakes up from the dream state, all the three components disappear simultaneously. No single component can be carried over. So when we are in the dream, what is taking place? There is a dreamer, there is a dream world, and there is a dream experience. When you wake up, what happens? When we say the dream is over, now I am awake, what has become over? The dreamer, the dream world, and the dream experience. All these three have vanished in toto. There is no trace of them left behind. The dreamer does not become the waker. The husband can never become the man. Why? Why the husband cannot become the man? Or the wife cannot become the woman?
Man is a substratum.
That's not the answer. Think. Why the husband cannot become the man? Because he's already the man. He's already the man. Man can become husband, but husband cannot become man. Think. So where is, what is husband? An apparition, a ghost, a virtual, an idea. Man is the reality. So all this duality is only an idea in the mind. Then what is mind? Essentially the self. Think. Wave is already the water. It cannot become water. Same way, the individual cannot become the self. Understand this. When the pursuit is objective in nature, then I want to realize, I want to realize, I want to become the self, I want to be the self. This itch, this desire will keep you in the mind. But individual can never become the self. Why? He is already the self. And when the husband thinks about the man, the husband, that very moment, the husband vanishes, only man remains. Same way, when the mind or the individual thinks about the self, the individual vanishes, only the self remains. When the Shishya thinks about the Guru, I should be a bit more careful with my usage of words. When the individual surrenders or contemplates on the self, both the individual and the self as an idea in the mind of the individual, both of them vanish. Because we are using the word self only to give our mind a direction, because it is used to taking support of words. So same way, just like the dreamer cannot become the waker, the dreamer, the dream world and the dream experience, all the three have to vanish in order for when one wakes up. No carryover is there from the dream. No, I will carry, I had the food in the dream, now I'm satisfied. Nothing, everything becomes zero. Exactly the same way, this waking experience that we have, the waker, the waking world and the waking experience in which we are doing the sadhana, and when we wake up, then all these three will vanish. All the relations, possessions, everything that you have called as mine, everything will go away. Everything that you have associated, including the person, the imaginary person, the waker. Waker is not a real person. Every day he comes and every day he goes away. So he is also an imaginary. He is also a ghost. He is not the real one. So just like we do not go back to the same dream, we do not have any idea after a second or two about the dreamer or the experiences of the dream and the relationships that we had and so on and so forth. Everything becomes just a figment of, I don't know what it was, I can't even remember it. Same thing happens. So here Bhagavan is, Swamiji is saying, when one wakes up from the dream state, all the three components disappear simultaneously. No single component can be carried over to the waking. Similarly, no component that I am a seeker, that I am I, that I am the body, that I am a father, mother, daughter, sister, that I am rich or poor, I am joyful or miserable. Nothing can be carried over to the self. Self, that's why self is pristine, immaculate. In the same way, an attempt to retain one's individuality intact and also reach a stage which is beyond the relativity of the waking state is an impossible undertaking, and this is the mistake that every one of us is making. We want to realize the truth while keeping the individuality intact, and that is not possible. An attempt to retain one's individuality intact and also reach a stage which is beyond the relativity of the waking state is an impossible undertaking. One has to think in totality and not in parts. What is in parts? How you are thinking right now. That I am sitting, that I am listening, that I am a father, that I am other, I am a man, my wife and daughter are woman, I was born, I am seeing, hearing, teaching, touching, feeling, tasting, I am getting old, I have these likes and dislikes, I am a waker, dreamer, sleeper. This is thinking in parts. What is thinking in whole? That I am pervading the whole body is thinking in whole. Yeah, you know there are different parts in the body, but you know you are pervading the whole body. So why don't you think, I am the one who is pervading the waking, dream and deep sleep? Expand. Why do you consider yourself only as the waker? Why we are living only 1/3 of our life? 1 waking is only 1/3 of our total experience. Why only 1/3, which we have given our sense of reality? And we are living at that level, stretching it every day in and day out and day in and day out. Think. So, expansion means accepting that waking experience, dream experience and sleep experience are all happening. The mind has to first accept that it is not shunting in and out of the mind, waking, dream and deep sleep. The deep sleep, the waking and the dream, these three experiences are happening to me, are happening in the mind. And who knows that these are happening? I know. Then I must be separate to these three. Expand. Only thinking like this only will expand you. But we are, because of our habit of seeing the differences, of having the sense of otherness, we see the self also as other than ourselves. We also want to grasp it. We want to own it, own the self. That will never happen. Because aprapya manasasaha. Mind has got no jurisdiction over that transcendental. Effect can never have the control over the cause. Wave can never understand the ocean or the waters. In that contemplation, the wave disappears. The waveness disappears. When the individuality contemplates on the total or the infinite, the individuality dissolves. in the Shuddha Chaitanya, there Shuddha Chaitanya, immaculate self, pure self, there is no trace of duality. It has the freedom to appear as the disciple and the guru simultaneously, but it never suffers the two-ness. Therefore, this is the Leela, this is the glory. That one without a second principle alone is expressing as the Guru and Shishya, but not affected by the Guru and Shishya, not influenced by the Guru and Shishya. Example, today's meditation. The space alone expresses as space the cause, air the effect. Air the cause, fire the effect. Fire the cause, water the effect. Water the cause, earth the effect. But the space is not affected by appearance or disappearance of the other four elements. Just like you are not affected, influenced by the disappearance of the dream experience. You are untouched. The space is untouched. Even though it is accommodating all the entire cosmos, it is untouched by the cosmos. The man is untouched by the father or the brother or the son or the husband. Man, or even though the roles are being played out, man remains the man. Then where are these roles? Only in imagination. Only in imagination. So imaginary entity is becoming miserable. Man is not becoming miserable. Husband becoming miserable because of wife. Man is not miserable. Husband is miserable. I am not realized. Individual is miserable. Self is not miserable. But individual cannot be without the self. So if we can come to this disposition wherein we see this play of Guru Shishya, Guru the self, Shishya the mind. See? Guru the master, Shishya the student. This. So what is that reality, transcendental reality? That Shuddha Chaitanya, pure self, which expresses as the duality, as the multiplicity, but never gets affected or influenced by the duality or the multiplicity. And who is an individual who gets affected and influenced by multiplicity and duality? But you have to change this. How can you change, bring about this change? Samatvam yoga uchyate, initial stage, and then merging. Control your senses, control your mind, remain equanimous. In the Shuddha Chaitanya, there is no trace of duality. It has the freedom to appear as the disciple and the guru simultaneously, but it never suffers two-ness. Just as another example I'll give you, which I've just now taken, the self alone expresses as the waker, waking world and the waking self experience, the dreamer, the dream world and the dream experience, the sleeper, the absence of the two, and the sleep experience of the absence of the two. Can these waking dream and sleep be possible without the self, without the life, without the Chaitanya Vastu? Not possible. Then are we affected by waking and dream and sleep? Yes, the individual waker who has taken this world to be real gets affected by the waking world. Because he has taken the dream to be an imagination, he is not affected by the dream. Yet, because of when he is in the dream, he is affected by the dream. Just like the waker is affected by the waking world, the dreamer is affected by the dream world. And some event in the dream world wakes him up. As long as everything is going fine in the dream, dream doesn't break. But when suddenly there is a hiccup in the beautiful flow of experiences in the dream, then suddenly you wake up. And when you wake up, you give zero value to the dream. So that one without a second, just like the space alone is expressing as the five elements, but not affected or influenced by the five elements. Water alone is expressing as the total ocean and the individual wave, and is not affected or influenced by the ocean or the wave, by their appearance or disappearance. Similarly, the self that I essentially am alone is expressing as the waker dream, waking world and the waking experience, dreamer dream world and the dream experience, and the same way with the sleep, but not affected or influenced by these three states. So take charge of this, be that principle. If you think of this principle, then you are in the waking. If you be that in spite of the thinking, there you are. We have not learned how to discriminate. When I ask you this question, did you...
Excuse me, iTunes needs your attention.
Okay. When I ask you the question that did you have waking dream and deep sleep experience yesterday, you say yes. Then who is answering this question? Can the waker answer this question? Because waker is not available in the dream, waker is not available in the sleep. Then who is saying that yes, I know yesterday I had the waking experience, dream experience and sleep experience? It must be the self. It must be that the one who is unaffected by the three. It must be the one who is the witness of the three. But we don't know how to separate these two. Who? The individual and the one who is transcendental. Because essentially both are same. See? And as long as we approach this true nature of ours objectively, till then it will not work. Because objective pursuit means keeping the individuality intact and wanting to know the truth also. That is not going to happen. Somewhere the penny must drop, that the individuality melts away, dissolves away in the contemplation of the... Yes, we begin with from where we are. But the individuality must dissolve. Now Nyaneshwar Maharaj expresses a sense of despair that he has had to repeat so often about the non-dual nature of the Guru Tattva. How much more can he keep saying? And we are also repeating the same examples and the same thoughts. So he is also feeling, because yato vacho nivartante aprapya manasa sah, that Guru Tattva is that which cannot be illuminated, which cannot be illuminated by the words, which cannot be comprehended by the mind, And yet these are the only two tools we have. And therefore, imagine what would be the experience of a dumb fellow. Listen carefully. What would be the experience of a dumb fellow, dumb who cannot speak, who has just eaten a chocolate and wants to express the joy of that wonderful taste? That is the state of realized masters. No words can do justice to that truth, to that self, pure self. No words. Words are limited. Words are born out of conditioning. Words are objective in nature. So when we are in that silence, we are the presence in that silence. But what happens to us? We do one satsang and we keep talking about it, talking about it, talking about it, because we have been affected by the satsang. Only mind can get affected, self cannot get affected. See? So instead of talking after satsang, remain silent. Let it percolate and go deep. Let the mind bask in the presence and lose itself in that eventually. Because the more we talk about it, the more we are going away from it. We individuals. So this is the despair which Jnaneshwar Maharaj did. How can I explain? I'm trying my best. But what's the time? Kim bahuna iya bhakha dvaita cha zetha upakha fedunia swasakha Shri Guru Vandila. What can be achieved by talking more? I salute my beloved Sadguru by rejecting the sense of duality. Conclusion. I can't do anything more. Enough of talking. How long will I go on saying the same thing? That is, that although there is a seeming duality in Guru-Shishya relationship, Guru is the non-dual conscious existence, and that the Guru is Guru because he is beyond duality. How many different ways I'll keep explaining the same thing? And when I repeat that there is no duality in the Guru, it does not mean that I support duality. When I say that there is no duality in the Guru, because I am using the word duality, it does not mean that duality is there. On the other hand, having rejected the very existence of duality, I have saluted my Guru, my beloved brother, Sadguru, and discovered the total identity between the Guru and the Shishya. This is our inner journey. Where the mind doesn't become anything. We become humans, individual. We become father, mother, daughter, sister. We become the employee. We become old. We become happy or unhappy. This is all becoming. What does it mean when the mind has merged into its source? Perception is there, but no ownership is there. So you see without becoming a seer. Becoming a seer, self becomes the seer. Self becomes the hearer, self becomes the experiencer. Remember the Triputi. Waker, waking world, waking experience. Dreamer, dreamer. All this erring, E-R, E-R, E-R. These are the becomings on account of something. Now imagine a disposition where waking experience is taking place, waking world is being perceived, but no waker is born. Because waker has merged into the self, now only self is. And then self is not saying, this is my waking experience. No, my. See? Then eyes are seeing, but the seer is not born. Ears are hearing, but the hearer is not born. So with all the senses. Activity is happening, but the doer is not born. Ecstasy is there, but the enjoyer is not born. What would it be like? We can't even imagine. We become silent, isn't it? How can it be that? How can it be possible? Yet, masters are living that way. They are living proofs. They are living proofs of this disposition. Every master was a Shishya once upon a time. Isn't it? So there is hope for us also. Rejection of the duality of Guru Shishya means the total absence of the sense of otherness. Sense of other means where there is distance between one and the other. Where there is two, there is sense of otherness. So is there a difference between the man and the husband? Is there a distance between it? Think. Is there a distance between the wave and the water? Ornament and the gold? Is there a distance? If not, then is there a distance between the individual and the infinite? Is there a distance between the Guru, Shishya and the Guru? As long as the Shishya keeps looking at the Guru as a separate person, he looks at him with a sense of otherness, till then duality will remain, distance will remain. When he accepts the Guru Atmatvena, when he accepts the Guru as the Self, then all duality vanishes, all objectivity vanishes, all differences vanish, all sense of otherness vanishes. So let's make our mind the disciple to contemplate on the Guru who is the Self alone, Atmatvena, that what I am seeking is already me. The mind must think, because mind is thinking at this moment. Self is not thinking. Mind is thinking. So mind has to think that what I am seeking, I already am. Until unless this doesn't happen, mind will not vanish, dissolve. Until and unless mind does not accept that I have to sleep, it will not go to sleep. It must be convinced about it. Same way, this seeker mind, Shishya mind, must be convinced must contemplate, must be fired up that what I am seeking, I already am in essence. Because consciousness with thoughts is called mind. So essence is consciousness only. See how beautiful. One, what can we talk after this? This is what Jnaneshwar Maharaj is also going through. Rejection of the duality of Guru Shishya means the total absence of the sense of otherness. It does not mean that if the Shishya has rejected the sense of disciplehood, he has become the equivalent of Guru. Having given up the disciplehood, that now I have given up, I am no longer a disciple, I have come to realize. If this thought is there, he is fooling himself. because realization means surrender to Guru, means neither the Guru remains nor the disciple remains.
Alert from Malwarebytes agent, version update available.
Neither the when the mind surrenders or the individuality surrenders, neither the individuality will be there as an idea, nor the self as an idea will be there. Neither the mind will be there, neither the idea, the essence. Oh, now I have come to know my essence. No, all words become null and void. Words become null and void. Words are applicable only where there is difference. Words are applicable only where there is sense of otherness. Words are applicable only when wherever there is objectivity. Both guruhood and shishyahood are annihilated in toto, once and for all. He has become the equivalent of the Guru. No, if it does not mean that the Shishya has rejected the sense of disciplehood. If we have rejected the sense of disciplehood, then it is a willful, it is a mind's imagination of giving up. It hasn't happened. He is giving up. He has become the equivalent of the Guru. No, he cannot. Because that would imply the retention of the duality in the mind. See? Because that would imply the retention of duality. If he has given up, that I am no longer a disciple. Why? I have got absolute clarity. I have come to know myself. Who will say this? Only he who is still in his mind. So this is the wonderful conundrum, that the one who knows cannot say he knows, and the one who doesn't know can never say that he knows. And if the one who doesn't know, if he says he knows, he has not known. And the one who says that he doesn't say anything, he knows. See? Now, how do you work this out? You cannot work it out. You have to get there, be that. In spite of saying, how long will I go on talking like this? Sant Jnaneshwar Maharaj continues to extol Guru's glory. When we look at a beautiful, fantastic movie, we keep talking about it. Free advertisement to everyone. Nobody is paying us. When we are influenced by some master, in some way or the other. We keep talking about his glory because of this master, this happened, this is how his grace flowed, this is how he helped me, this is how this is what I experienced when I was in his or her presence. We keep talking about it. That master has not given asked you anything, but you yourself keep talking about it. Same way, if while listening to satsang, we have come close proximity to this principle, to this essence that I am, the mind has become silent as a result of listening without going to sleep. It becomes thrilled by the magnanimity of the self, because it is essentially the self. When the waves subside, the orb of the moon becomes available, and the light, in the light of that reflection, reflected moon, everything, the light is much more clarity. But when there are too many waves, then the amount of light that is getting reflected from the waters is less. Same thing happens with the mind. When too many thoughts are there, the self, without the self, you cannot have the thoughts. Life has to be there. But as the thoughts subside, the reflection of the self, this I gets thrilled, hey, I am. It starts revealing its true nature. It may be objective initially, yes. You are sussing it out. And when we begin the when we inquire into this, who am I, then even that I vanishes, because reflected I is not my true nature. Reflected moon may be having all the qualities of the moon, but it is not the real moon. A real moon is beyond the waters, transcendental to the waters. I can create from one moon, I can create million moons if I got a million buckets of water. We are the buckets. Billions of individuals are created by the reflection, in billions of intellects. The reflection. So if we want to go back to be the original, now that water example is over. Now don't think, oh, the sun is, the moon is so up in the sky, I have to go up somewhere in the sky to find the self. No. That example had its own limitations. And when see, so when this mind surrenders, it gets thrilled. It cannot stop talking, just like I can't stop talking about the scriptures, you can't stop listening. We feel a joy, we feel a sense of completion. We feel we have come back to the source when we are exposed to these words, isn't it? Or are we going away from the satsang? I have to remember every word by heart. Is it? No. Similarly, Jnaneshwar Maharaj, even though he says that how long will I go on talking like this, yet he continues to sing the glory of the Guru Maharaj. Continues to sing the glory of the Guru Maharaj. A devotee, he begins with devotion to the Isht, to the Lord, and after surrender to the Lord, he continues to sing the glory of the Lord. He doesn't stop. Now that I have realized the God, I have merged into the God, I have had the darshan of the Lord, now I don't need to take his name. No, he continues singing the name, chanting the name. Exactly the same way. Exactly the same way. Jnaneshwar Maharaj is continuing to sing the glory of the Lord. याच्या सख्याची नवाई आंगी एक पणा ठाव नाही आणि गुरु शिष्य दुवाळीही पवाडू केला. द लव ऑफ माय सद्गुरु इज मोस्ट वंडरफुल. इन हिम देर इज नॉट इवन अ मेन्शन ऑफ वननेस. ही इज स्पोर्टिंग द ग्लोरियस लीला ऑफ गुरु एंड शिष्य. देर इज नॉट इवन अ मेन्शन ऑफ वननेस. Because if he uses the word one, then two is created. Therefore, anadi. Therefore, birthless. Therefore, transcendental. We'll look at this verse next time. I think enough for today. It's never enough. I can keep going if you have the free day. So this is the way we apply ourselves to ourselves. We have ourselves created the guru idea in us. We have ourselves created the shishya idea in us. We are ourselves the shishya. Instead of seeking a guru outside, seek the guru within. And when we have realized the guru, neither the Shishya will remain nor the Guru will remain. Yet the drama will continue. Jnaneshwar Maharaj is also a realized master. His teacher, his elder brother Nivritti Nath is also a realized master. Every moment here, remember, he is writing Amrit Anubhav is his experience of realization. It is his experience of realization. His guru ordered him to write his experience of realization. And as he is narrating his experience through these various OVs, using the word guru, using the word shishya, he knows he is the brother, but he is not coming down from the absolute principle. He is always having that eagle's viewpoint of everything. He is always having the Purnamada Purnameda principle. Because that's what he is. Therefore he can speak like this. For some moments during this satsang, we also take that position. But we are not able to stay there permanently. Because then the world latches on. So even though it is his brother, it is his guru, yet he has realized. So that brother, being a brother, is not an impediment in his realization. Being a disciple of his Guru Maharaj is not an impediment. Then why is he using the words if he has realized? Leela. Leela. That is the glory. That is the leela. It's not that words are not going to be used. Words will be used even after realization. Masters also use it. But there is no sense of ownership. Why? They have merged into the infinite. Now infinite is speaking. Whether it be Shirdi Sai Baba or Satya Sai Baba or Ammachi or Ramana Maharishi or Nisargadat Maharaj, Akhandananji Maharaj, Chinnananji Maharaj, is the totality, the infinitude which is functioning through. There is no ownership of anything because phenomena will continue. Phenomena will not stop. How long will the phenomena continue? it will, this here it is not given, I am adding as long as this body is there. How long will the body be there? As long as its destiny is there. And nobody knows how long will it be there. So accept this, just like you enjoy the dream after waking up for a few seconds if something was interesting, and afterwards you forget. So you remain, so we continue to the phenomena will function, continue to function. So the, as we understood from the first chapter, Shiva Shakti Samavesh, this is called Chid Vilas. Vilas means enjoyment. Chid is the enjoyment of the consciousness with itself. So what is the difference between the wave on the river and the ocean? The waves on the river have a purpose to merge into the ocean. So that is not Chid Vilas. Chid Vilas is the waves on the ocean. Why are the waves on the ocean being created? Is it out of any need? Is it out of any reason? Is it out of any shortcoming? Is it out of any separation? Or is it out of the inherent joy of the ocean that it expresses as the waves to play with itself? This is Chid Vilas. So the self has the freedom to express or not to express, manifest or not to manifest. And when that happens, when that Parama Shiva chooses to express or not express, that thought comes, it can do anything. It appears as Shiva and Shakti because he is all accomplished. So he appears as Shiva Shakti. Now the play begins. So this infinite consciousness that I am, the infinite self, the pure self that I am, it alone appears as the I, the aham, and that the idam in the mind. The moment there's one becomes the two, the play begins, the life begins, the waking dream sleep begins, the duality begins. How long? Till it gets absorbed again in sleep, or till it gets absorbed again in realization. If we take that to be real, we want to realize. But if we take the Shiva Shakti position, then, oh, this is going on, everything is divine, and will not be affected by anything. We'll always remain established in the self as Shiva is. Shiva has never forgotten his essential nature. And he knows the Shakti is part and parcel of him. She is his Ardhangini. She is his potentiality. Do you know that your mind is your potentiality? Do you know that your mind is your Ardhangini? Do you know that I cannot be without that? Do you know that? Have you experienced that? Have you come to this conclusion within yourself? See? So, even after knowing the Guru Shishya relationship between Jnaneshwar Maharaj and his guru Nivrittinath, it continues even after he has realized. Because now it's a leela. Now it's a leela. So may this great master who is still living in Samadhi, may he bless us with this vision, with this disposition, that we come to to be true to the experience that he is having. Where he is abiding, may we abide. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om. Hari Om. Hari Om, Hari Om.
Thank you, Swamiji.
Hari Om, take care.
Hari Om, Swamiji.
Hari Om, Swamiji.
Take care, take care.
Thank you.